Okay, we're going to take a look at Trinity, the development of the doctrine of Trinity in three stages. But first of all, let me do a quick introduction. The Trinity is a very hot topic right now in Adventism for two reasons. One is there is a number of Adventist groups that are challenging the idea of the personality of the Holy Spirit. This is particularly a difficulty in Brazil, and it also has difficulties other places in the world. But the second thing is that is challenging the doctrine of the Trinity is the full divinity of the Son and the eternity of the Son. There are those who would like to argue that the Son is not entirely divine. And that was the original challenge in the 3rd and 4th century as well, one of them. So there's some similarities. Because there's these challenges in Adventism, there have been a number of things that have come out on Trinity recently and more happening for the future. There was a couple of Trinity conferences, one that I took part in down at Southern University back in 2006. And there's some very good lectures from that are available online at the ATS website. They are sound only, they're not video, but sound only on the ATS website, including a presentation I gave there, and about 16 presentations by different people on Trinity. And we just finished a Trinity conference down at Monte Morelos. That's why I was late to this class, because I got delayed down in Monterrey, Mexico, on my way back. And there we had several presentations, probably 15 presentations that will eventually be available online in Spanish, of course, with video and audio. But there's also going to be a book probably come out of that one, but it will again be in Spanish. I helped author this book, The Trinity, which is a good overview of the Trinity in history, scripture, and in Adventism. And the chapters I wrote on this were the early church and the Middle Age chapters. And the reason I got involved in it, Woody Whidden was actually writing the book, and he realized he didn't know some of the key things he wished he would have known from the early church. And so he asked the question at an ASRS meeting, does anybody know how the Holy Spirit made it into the Trinity in the 4th century? Well, I had just read this book a few weeks before that time. This is Basil on the Holy Spirit, which is basically the book that convinced a lot of people to view the Holy Spirit as a full member, a full person of the Godhead. And in the 4th century. And so I raised my hand and said, well, a large part of it was Basil of Caesarea's writing of the book on the Holy Spirit, where he went through all the different texts in the scriptures that used all the different prepositions of the Holy Spirit and showed that the Holy Spirit was a full member of the Godhead. And he says, oh, great, see me afterwards. And then he asked me if he had write in the book. Jerry Moon was also elected to help with this book because of his understanding of Trinity within Adventism. Since then, this book came out, I think, in 2001. Since then, a number of articles have been done on the Trinity in Adventism. So as follow-up from the lectures I'm giving here, I'm going to suggest in 2003 seminary studies, Andrews University Seminary Studies, Jerry Moon has a two follow-up articles on the Trinity in Adventism. One of them is called The Adventist Trinity Debate, Part 1, and it's a historical overview. The second one is Adventist Trinity Debate, Part 2, obviously, The Role of Ellen G. White. And since 2003, there have been a number of studies that have been done on Ellen White in the Trinity, and one of them is should be coming out soon by Merlin Burt. He made a presentation down at Montemorelos, and he also made a presentation at a conference they had in Brazil on the Holy Spirit 2 years ago. And the presentations he made on the Holy Spirit there and in Montemorelos should be coming out. I'm not sure what form they're going to be published, but they should be available soon. There's also Denis Kaiser is bringing out an article on Ellen White's role and the role of her three books on Christ that she wrote in Australia, Desire of Ages, Thoughts from the Mount of Blessing, and Christ's Object Lessons, particularly Desire of Ages, kind of settles the debate within Adventism at that time, in the aftermath of it. So that's kind of an update on where Trinity is today. Also, I put in a chapter on the Trinity in this book that just came out this year. I believe it came available in May of this year. Always Prepared. It's kind of a general book on apologetics, as it were, of Adventist doctrines for a informed collegiate audience. And I put in there the chapter, Why It Is That We Do Not Worship Three Gods. And I had three sections to the chapter. One of them was a quick overview of the Trinity, how God is three and God is one from Scripture. And then I look specifically at the Holy Spirit because of the challenges that we're having now within Adventism on the Holy Spirit. And I talk about the personhood of the Holy Spirit and then go on to talk about the beauty of the Trinity and the function of the Trinity as God in relationship. And that is, I think, a key piece of understanding the Trinity and why I think the Trinity is an important doctrine to get right. Now, going back to the early church, I want to introduce this book, probably the best book summarizing the early church on the Trinity. It's by Augustine. So it is written in the early 5th century, and it's just called The Trinity, or De Trinitate is the title he gave it. And It's got a number of books, but there's really two halves to it. There's 15 books, but after book 8, he shifts his focus from arguing the Trinity from the Bible and early church fathers to arguing the function of the Trinity. But in the very end of it, there's a quote that I like to read that... I can find it now. I've got a new copy of it, and I don't have my new copy marked. I believe it's the beginning of book 15, but it might be in the beginning of the prologue. Let me summarize it instead of reading it, because I can't find it fast enough. He basically, after writing the best book ever to date, that date on the Trinity, ends up saying, "Do not consider, after we have defined our understanding of the Trinity, that we have defined God." He says, "Let us be aware that we are always going to be looking at a subset of the information about God. God is always going to be bigger than us, impressive to us, and mysterious to us, because God is not to be put into a box like the human mind, not to be put into human logic either. There are many things about God that we will be continuing to understand for eternity." And I think he makes a very good point that when we get done understanding our best shot at a doctrine of God, it's not as if we've defined God. We've just described what we know of his self-revelation. And, therefore, I'm going to appeal to the idea of not insisting that the Trinity be completely logical from Aristotelian logic. One of the difficulties that Arius, the great anti-Trinitarian of the fourth century, got into is he tried to make a logical doctrine, a doctrine that stood up to Aristotle's logic. And I think he caused himself a problem. You see, God reveals himself in Scripture as three. Some passages where that happens clearly are at the baptism of Jesus, for instance. It's multiple gospels tell about the baptism of Jesus, but the composite picture we get of the baptism of Jesus is that Jesus himself, the God-man, incarnate God, is being baptized in the water by John. And there's a voice comes from heaven, the Father speaking, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased," if I may quote the King James Version, which I memorized as a kid and still have it. And of course, then the Holy Spirit, the third member of the Godhead, is descending in a bodily form, ironically, in the form of a dove. Some people say that we never see the Holy Spirit in bodily form, but we do there, interestingly enough. So three is clear, simultaneous three, okay? And the Bible also strongly identifies God as one. Going back to Deuteronomy 6:4, the Shema that is said in the Middle Ages and the late antique world on a daily basis by the Jews, as reported by the Masoretes, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." That is a clear definition of the oneness of God, clear appeal by Judaism to the oneness of God. In fact, they use that as an appeal against the multiplicity or the enumeration of God by the Christians, even. One of the reasons I think they say the Shema on a daily basis after the rise of Christendom was to kind of say, take that, Christians, we view God as one. And of course, there is the statement of about Allah being one, that Islam uses, and they say that at least five times a day. They want to outstrip the Jews, who say it only one time a day, and they say it five times a day, and end up saying, reaffirming the oneness of God over and against Christians, whom they call polytheists. But here's the irony. Christians do not call themselves worshiping three gods. We view ourselves as worshiping one God. And the reason we say one God is because God revealed himself in Scripture as one God. And the reason we say three persons is because God revealed himself in Scripture as three. So there's a oneness and there's a threeness. Now, the logical part is to say, is it one or is it three? The Trinity statement is to say, we're not going to hold it to mathematical logic here. We're going to take both things as revealed and hold them as true, even though they're in tension with each other. This is why I argue that the Trinity, the term the Trinity, is not a solution to the problem. The term the Trinity is a recognition that our logic cannot handle the problem, but we need to name it to talk about it. So it is simply a recognition of the tension between the threeness of God and the oneness of God, and not willing to give up either one of them simply because both are revealed, self-revealed by God in Scripture. So God is three, God is one. Come to us from Scripture, God's self-revelation. And the Trinity is a term that simply names the tension. Triune, three in one, Trinity. Okay, so let's take a look at some background information. In reality, the early church was trying to understand who Christ was. So The fact that I'm going to give you a lecture on Trinity is actually going to begin on a lecture about identifying Christ, which is, of course, the initial lecture on Christology, because the Trinity debate was on its way toward understanding Christology. You can't understand who Christ is as God until you understand a little bit more about who God is. So on the way toward understanding who Christ is, the early church defined God as Trinity, or recognized God's self-revelation as God and Trinity. But the earliest part was a discussion of who is Christ. We worship one God, and Jesus Christ is his Son, whom we also worship. This becomes a problem. Let's take a look, a memory actually, of the discussion on philosophy for a minute. You remember that I had talked about Plato's One. And in Plato's One is a monotheism. Okay, so there is, and he got to Plato's One on the basis of logic going back, there can only be one source. And the one, the monotheism of the philosophers is a monotheism of one simple, single source of all else. And so the development of Plato's dyad, or second, was not an explanation of source now, but was an explanation of how this one interacts with the physical world, the material world. So the dyad was necessary to be the intermediary between the one and the world. Cosmos, physical world. Okay? This is a little different than what we're going to find in Christianity, and it's a little different than what we're going to find in the scripture as Christ reveals who he is. But this is in the background, and this is where one of the misconceptions comes in as to understanding Christ as less than the one source God. Okay, then of course you have the pneuma down here. I'm not sure. Okay, the pneuma down here is something that's not sure whether it is part of the world or part of the divine, or the divine part that is surrounding the world, etc. And when we get to, I'll get to a lecture, probably not till Thursday, actually on the Holy Spirit as a force in Stoicism, Middle Platonism and Stoicism. When I get there, we will understand that. But this view of God is in the background of the thinking people at the time when Christianity was trying to come to terms with who God was and who Jesus was, who the Christ was. So let's take a look at one of the people that is trying to understand God in a philosophical way just before the Christological problem within Christianity, and that is Philo of Alexandria. Philo, of course, he is concurrent with Jesus. He's writing his De Opificio Mundi, or on the creation of the world, or on the making of the world. He's writing that at about the time Christ is doing his preaching. Now, we don't have an exact date for either of those events, but during the time frame in which Christ is having his public ministry, Philo is writing down in Alexandria. And what he does there is he describes the one God, and then he describes a bunch of intermediaries with the world, which he calls agents. Or powers, of God. Okay? So you've got, and he's got one called dunamis. He's got one called logos. He's got one called sophia. He's got one called dunamis. And he's got several others. I think I one time counted seven of them that I found in Deo Perficio Mundi. I don't have the list on the top of my head, but that's just enough there to show you. These are agents of God. Now, are they different or are they all the same? Are they the same agent of God with different names? This is ambiguous in Philo. But at some point, he talks as if these were all the same. And they're different aspects to the agents of God that are God sending out his powers to do his will, because he himself stays separate from the material world. Very Platonic system here. So it's unclear whether these equal the dyad or whether one of them might equal the dyad, because Philo's ambiguous on this point. At least I think he's ambiguous. There are people that know these things. But I think they know more than they can know. There, you know, if you try to press text too far, you can end up knowing things that really aren't said in the text. So I have a tendency to be conservative in what I think I can know from a text. So to me, when I read it several times through looking for these, it looked as if they may have been the same, but it wasn't clear. So that's why I present it as a equal sign with a little maybe over it. Okay? So it ends up, though, they are divine agents. And this is also is in the background, now applied not just in a general way to the divine realm versus the realm of the world, but specifically to the realm of the divine and the world in Genesis, an interpretation of Genesis. Because on the making of the world is a description of Genesis 1, the hexameron. Okay? So then we come to the problem within Christianity. Let me give you one more thing before we go on. I want to remind you that Aristotle's 1 has some similarities with Plato's 1. Okay? Except that Aristotle goes a step further to an unmoved mover. And I'm going to put down here in parentheses, so Aristotle's one is the unmoved mover. And the reason this is an important aspect to add on to this is that within Plato, you have, I'm going to make this a little more clear. You have the one, the monad, is the source of all. But for Aristotle, he is the absolute source. And there's the relationship between the unmoved mover and all else is more direct in Aristotle. For instance, in Plato, you actually end up, at least in the Timaeus, having a creation of the world. In the Phaedrus, it's not quite so clear that the cosmos has a beginning. But in Aristotle, you definitely have an eternal universe. He makes 8 arguments for the eternity of the universe and then has the unmoved mover start it all in motion. And so material is forever, and then the organization of material comes from the unmoved mover, et cetera, et cetera. But the relationship between the unmoved mover and the world is more direct in Aristotle than it is in Plato. Okay. Let's jump now to some second century Christians whom you have read and loved and are now going to ask a new question of. You read Irenaeus. I believe I gave you book 3, section 23 and following to the end of the book. Which is where he describes his understanding of Jesus Christ. Now, he's got a few things he describes there that are very important to salvation, and we will take them up directly with Christology and talk about it in depth with Christology next week. But for right now, let's be aware that Irenaeus needs to have, for his understanding of salvation, he needs to have Christ, Jesus Christ, be fully God. His statement is something like fully God and fully human. And he needs this because he visualizes Jesus Christ as the bridge between the Creator and the creature, between God and humans, between the holy God and the fallen humans. So the way to get humans back in relationship to God is the bridge of Jesus Christ. As bridge, he himself is the connection. If he is a bridge on a canyon that only reaches 3/4 of the way each direction, it's not a very effective bridge. Picture for a minute the Snake River Canyon with a bridge built in the middle that doesn't quite reach either side. How useful is that? It's not useful at all. So with this idea, Irenaeus is arguing that you have to have Christ be all the way human and all the way God in order to bridge between the two. Okay? He says that it should be and it must be, but he doesn't say how it could be. He does not go into the how could it be. And oftentimes, a doctrine begins with a belief that something is, and then later tries to explain how it is. And most often, we get in trouble trying to overdefine the how. Irenaeus took the very safe place of not trying to describe the how at all, which left many of his contemporaries very frustrated because they wanted some how, but even more so with those that came later. You have some people who step in to try to say how, and I'll talk about them in a few minutes. First of all, let me jump next to Theophilus. I'm sure that you have become quite fond of Theophilus through these readings of him. Little tongue-in-cheek there. But Theophilus is sometimes touted as the first one who uses the term Trinity. And it's true. He uses the Greek word trios, which really isn't Trinity, but it's threeness applied to God. And he obviously believes in one God, so it counts as Trinity. Unfortunately, Theophilus's Trinity looks a little different than what we'd like it to look. Theophilus argues that the Trinity is made up of God and his two hands, Logos and Sophia. I don't know if you remember reading that. But his two hands, Logos and Sophia, then is what through which he makes the world. And it's kind of similar to Philo's agents of God. In fact, Philo has two of those agents being Logos and Sophia, and it is through them he makes the world. Okay? Of course, there's many passages in Proverbs and in Psalms that identify this. And you could say, well, that would be fine, except then afterwards he introduces the idea of a pneuma, and it looks as if his Logos and Sophia are both descriptions of the Son. So his Trinity is confused a bit. We don't have Father, Son, and Spirit in Theophilus's Trinity. We have Father, Son, and another rendition of Son. And the Spirit, he enters later. It's not part of the three. So it's interesting. His main point is not describing God there. His main point is describing humans. And Theophilus makes a side point on his way through, so he's really not making a Trinitarian doctrine at all. But he is used as such later on, much later on, by some who are trying to find a Trinity doctrine early in the second century. The main point Theophilus is actually making is about the human, he says. And in the fourth place is the human. And reflecting like the moon reflects the sun, does not have life in and of himself, in other words, but completely and totally dependent upon the life source for life. So his point in talking about this trios, these three of God, is not making a statement about God so much, he's making a statement about humans. God has, the human has need. So what God has to offer is what the human needs. So the human is dependent upon God. That's Theophilus's point. Then we have Tertullian. Tertullian has an interesting set of views on God, and I'm going to put a couple of them on the board just to understand. I don't know who's got the ye here, but we'll do without it. Tertullian has a monarch and two lieutenants. Maybe I better make it like this so that you don't confuse them with logoi. Okay? So monarch and two lieutenants. And he actually talks to them kind of being like they were a father and two sons. He uses this terminology. But clearly what he's meaning is that God the Father is the monarch, and two of his lieutenants are the Son and the Spirit. Now, he does this by way of showing that there's one God, but there's three persons. So he gets a piece of it right here, but he also gets a piece wrong. And the piece he gets wrong is the idea of source. His source of the other two, the source of the godness, comes from the monarch. It looks a little too much like this. And there's an inherent subordinationism here. Yes? There's many descriptions that Tertullian gives, and one of them goes that way, and it looks like this. Father, Son, Spirit. Okay, and this is what actually gets argued from Tertullian in the Middle Ages, and this becomes a sore point between Latin theology and Greek theology, which becomes a contention between Roman Catholic theology and Orthodox theology, and this is actually what they end up splitting on. Is the Spirit coming from the Father and the Son, which is the term "and the Son" is filioque, filio being Son and ke being and. So if the source of the Spirit is the Father and the Son, then we have something like this that ends up being the actual creed in the 7th, 8th century. But the Orthodox reject that, and they go with something that looks more like this again, separate. Tertullian has both models, and you can get either from them. But both of them contain what I view as the problem with Tertullian's mode. That is, you've got source, and you've got those that come from. And there's an inherent subordinationism to source and those that come from. His Tertullian's main point is to try to make sure that you have the Son actually sharing the nature of the Father. That's his important point. So he uses terms like true God, from true God. And he has another one. He says, light from light, which doesn't work anymore with our physics, but it worked great with their physics. From their physics, they figured that the sun ray was made of the same stuff that the sun was made of. Or the ray of light that comes from the candle is made of the same stuff as that which is light in the candle. So they viewed light as a something. Now, we view light as a something also. But the source of light isn't necessarily the same thing as light. So from the fusion of atomic particles in the sun end up emitting photons from the high energy reactions that are releasing heat at magnificent magnitudes. Now, what is a photon? We get real smart in talking about photons until we try to actually describe what one is. And we end up saying, well, it's kind of like a particle sometimes, and it's kind of like a wave sometimes, so we call it a wavicle, which is another way of saying, I don't know, but it sounds more impressive. So there's a lot of things we don't know about light, but what we do know about light is that light is not the same substance as the source of light is from physics. They didn't know that, and so don't hold them to our understanding of light. For their, this was a statement that guaranteed the same substance between the source and that which comes from. Now, it does work if you use a spring and stream. If you have a spring of water and a stream coming from it, they're both water, and that does work. So if Tertullian were to be doing this today, he'd probably say spring and stream. Because light from light, he didn't realize that light shining actually is coming from interactions and oxidation and other things on our planet, and from fusion and fission in other planets. So the stars are fission stuff. But you know, Tertullian wasn't worried about that stuff. Okay, so this becomes very influential in the early church. Several things about this remain. These two statements make it into the creed of Constantinople as they made it into the creed of Nicaea. But we'll talk about that when we get to that stage. Yeah. Yeah, so we'll get both of these statements make both all of the creeds. Of the ecumenical councils. We retain these two statements. Now, the difficulty I have with this is this word right here. I have a little difficulty with that. But then I'm a strong egalitarian, so maybe it's my problem. But I do have a difficulty with that. And I'll tell you why when we get a little later on. Okay, let's take a look at another person. We've got Origen. I'm going to have to erase some of this stuff and put a couple of people on the board here at the same time. You've got all this down so I can erase it now? Okay. Because I run out of board space. They only gave me one great big board up here. And so I'm going to erase this and start over and set up the problem coming out of the 3rd century. I think we'll have room to keep Tertullian here on the side. Okay, now I'm going to put Origen over here. Let's see, I'm going to put Origen over on this side. Okay, so Origen ends up with some statements in his De Principiis on First Principles, which you read, and also in his John commentary, particularly in book 2, that clarify that when he's referring to the relationship between the Father and the Son, he does not see them as having the same nature, but that the Son shares participating in the godness of the Father. Okay? And this is expressed in several ways. In De Principiis, it was expressed that the Logos was one of the pre-existing souls hanging around God in eternity. You remember that stage one of our 6 stages that I put on the board. Okay, so picture that. Logos is not God there. Logos is a soul, which is in the divine realm, but is not God. Okay, so Logos participates in the godness of the Father when he stays true to to the Father, contemplating the Father continually, and then comes to earth as the example of the Father to those on earth, and then shows them how to get back to the Father. It's not clear in his circumstances, in Origen's readings of this, what Christ ends up as, what the Logos ends up as. Because he says that, following Ephesians 1:23, that Christ ends up as all in all. And this all in all is not what he was to start with. His source was one of the souls, as a Logos. But his ending as all in all. So his apokatastasis at the end of stage 6 shows that it is Christ above all, and that everything is in submission to Christ. That's not how it started. So there's some ambiguity in Origen there, but the big point that comes out of it, and he stresses this in John Commentary Book 2, is that Jesus Christ is God by participation. As opposed to by nature. And he says it in the John Commentary Book 2, he says it clearly. If it were possible that the Son would stop contemplating the Father eternally, he would cease to be God. That statement makes sense if you're remembering what he said in De Principiis. It doesn't make sense by itself. You have to know something of Origen's background and understand why he's saying that. And it's kind of a statement he makes and then he runs on. And yet you're left with, where'd that come from? We're talking about Jesus being true God here, and then he goes to this statement. But if it were possible that he would stop contemplating the Father eternally, or continuously, I think the term is, he would cease being God. That insists that Origen believes that Jesus Christ was not God by nature, but was God by participation in the Father's nature. Okay. Eventually, this becomes a problem. Pardon me? It does, but he does not explain that in the John Commentary. But if you remember what he wrote in De Principiis, then it makes sense in the John Commentary. Yes? Stretching, okay. So this becomes an important byproduct later. Now remember something about Origen. Origen is the most influential interpreter of Scripture in the early church. So originally, everybody wants to have Origen on their side, or they want to be on Origen's side. Later, in the 5th century, he gets condemned as a heretic, and people start backing away from Origen and do not want to be seen with him anymore, and Origen becomes a pariah when he becomes a heretic. But that's after the fact of both Nicaea and Constantinople. In fact, it's in the wake of Constantinople that people start bringing accusations against Origen. Why? Because he does not agree with what they decided God was at Constantinople. Now, but Origen stays important in the dialogue, particularly before Nicaea. Okay, there's one more person I need to put on the board here, and then there's a couple of more people I'll talk about on our way to understanding Arius. But let's put a guy by the name of Sabellius up here. Sabellius lived in the 2nd century. I don't know exactly when he died off the top of my head. I didn't get that detail for us here. But he's late 2nd century. And he comes up with an understanding of God that he thinks solves the problem of the three and one. And it does. It describes a how for the three and one. Unfortunately, in describing the how, he creates a whole new basket of problems. But let's put it up here. He originally has it as modalism. Let me grab a... And there's two ways to describe modalism. Sibelius's modalism was a chronological modalism. And basically, in the Old Testament times, God revealed himself as the Father. So the person of God was the Father. In the New Testament times, the time of the incarnation, God revealed himself as the Son. So the person of God was the Son. And then in the times of the church, God revealed himself as the Holy Spirit. So the person of God is the Holy Spirit. So, the person of God is the Father during the time of the Old Testament. Person of God is the Son during the New Testament. And the person, or the incarnation, and the person of God is the Holy Spirit in the time of the age of the church. So you have one person in three modes. Tidally deals with the three in one. What problems arise here? So Scripture is going to deny this. At least chronological modalism is easily denied because all you got to do is look and say, well, how many times did the Son pray to the Father and the Father talk to the Son? And you obviously have two people there. And then the Son says, I'm going to go and send you the Holy Spirit. From Sibelius' viewpoint said, why did the Son have to leave before the Holy Spirit arrived? Because they're the same person. He needed to go change modes and come back. Weak. It doesn't stand up to Scripture. Jesus says, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. And I will send the Comforter who will be with you. Now, is there some ambiguity there? Yes. Are we absolutely clear on every little aspect of which role, which member of the Godhead is taking? No. Is it clear that they're in relationship with each other? Yes. Why would Jesus bother to say, I and my Father are one, if they weren't both existing? Now, from Sibelius' viewpoint, he would say, no, that's not what he means. He means I and my Father are actually one, the same person. But why is he talking in the present tense? Why did Jesus never say, back then, I was the Father, and now I am the Son? He never says that. Now, to his credit, or to his defense, there are statements confusing who is Yahweh in the Old Testament. What member of the Godhead is represented by Yahweh in the Old Testament? There's some confusion there because I think there are times when you have Yahweh identified with the Father, sometimes Yahweh's identified with the Son. I don't know off the top of my head a place where Yahweh is identified with the Holy Spirit, unified with the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament, but I'm sure if I asked Dick Davidson, he would know. But the reality is, Yahweh is ascribed to the Son and also to the Father. And there is some text, like we talked about, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. We're assuming we're talking about the Son. And the government shall be upon his shoulders. This sounds like the elevation of the Son afterwards to be the all in all, like Ephesians 1:23 has. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father. Now, texts like that, Sibelius would say, see, they're the same person. And we would say, see, they share the same roles sometimes. The God is more comfortable referring to himself as three and yet not clearly defining the roles between them than we are. Systematic theology has a way of trying to divide God too completely sometimes. And Scripture just doesn't quite do that. Yeah. Okay, so this is Sabellius's idea. And quite frankly, because it doesn't meet Scripture, it gets rejected by most of the church. Okay? There's lack of scriptural support for this, therefore they reject it. But it's extreme one. As opposed to this, which I would call extreme two. Not even God unless participating in the godness of the Father. Okay, so we have something, attention building within the church. Come down through the late third century, and Origen's ideas are very popular, and they're being fought by guys like Paul of Samosata, who's a Sabellian. And he's got a dynamic modalism in which he tries to deal with some of the chronological problems with his dynamic modalism. I don't buy it. He still ends up with the same problems, in my opinion. But, and so did the rest of the church. They say he does not solve the scriptural problems. He just tries to address it as not just strictly chronological anymore. But still, one person, three modes, he pushes to having sometimes the three modes simultaneous. I mean, he has to. Scripture has them. But it's not satisfying. So Paul of Samosata, as the next generation of Sabellian, is still rejected as much as this portion of Origenism is being rejected. So there's two things that people are trying to say. These aren't quite right. This is not what Scripture tells us. Irenaeus still has the right answer. All true God and all true human. Okay? And people are turning to Tertullian's terminology to deal with that. A guy by the name of Novatian ends up over here following Tertullian terminologically. Also writing in Latin, by the way. This is the Novatian of the Novatian controversy. The Novatian controversy where he's talking about whether we can should rebaptize people who were baptized by a heretic or not. And saying, oh yes, we must, et cetera, et cetera. Very much following Tertullian and Cyprian's ideas of automatic or objective salvation. But he follows Tertullian also in terminology. So Novatian writes a book called On the Trinity, or De Trinitate, in which he uses Tertullian's terminology, thinking he's in the middle with Irenaeus. But Tertullian tries to say how a little too much. Irenaeus leaves it ambiguous, so he's pristinely unassailable. If you don't say too much, then you can't get too attacked. But Novatian and others are trying to get rid of Sabellius and Paul of Samosata and Origen. Okay, so this is kind of the situation we're in when we are approaching the end of Roman persecution and the beginning of the Roman Christian era, in which things can be more open and communication can be more open, and suddenly you can send official church mail on military boats. And not only is it legal, it's encouraged. You can actually, with a legal Christianity, you can communicate with everybody all the time. And so communication ramps up a lot. And then we have Constantine comes into the mix trying to say, okay, we've got confusion on the definition of God, and if Christianity is going to be the glue of my empire, we need to have some understanding of what God is. So we need to have a council, bring everybody who knows everything, bring them together, have them discuss it, and make a decision. what definition of God are we going to use and make it solid? And that is the God we'll all worship. Okay? Very pagan way of doing a Christian theology. But after all, Constantine was that. So he calls a council. Now, right here I'm going to stop and put a sidebar on. And the reason I put a sidebar on here is because this is kind of the way everyone is aware of at the beginning of the council. When the bishops are coming to the council, they're saying, we're not sure what Origen is doing, but he's old. We do know what Paulus, Samosata, and Sabellius are doing, and we need to make sure that we get rid of this extreme oneness that destroys the threeness in actuality. So we need to get rid of Sabellius and Paulus, Samosata. That was on their minds going to the council. They're going to use scripture to fight against heresy at the council to condemn modalism. Now, the sidebar is this. Meanwhile, back in Alexandria, we find a presbyter by the name of Arius. And he is disagreeing with his bishop, who is, an easy name to remember, Alexander of Alexandria. Okay? So Alexander of Alexandria has a secretary whose name you might recognize by the name of Athanasius. Young guy, 19 years old, bright student, kind of his the equivalent of his graduate assistant. It's actually his secretary, okay? Okay, so Arius is teaching things about Jesus that Alexander does not accept. And so he starts making statements in Alexandria against the teachings of Arius. And when the council at Nicaea is called in 325, Alexander comes with the agenda to expose Arius and his ideas as wrong. Everyone else is coming with the agenda to expose Sabellius and Paulus Samosata and their ideas as wrong from Scripture. There it's set for stage two. Stage two of Trinitarianism in the early church is the Council of Nicaea itself. So the question arises, why the diversity during stage one, why the diversity in the understandings of God in the early church? Was it a product of the time? Is it a product of their own presuppositions? Is it a geographic thing? I will say that it's a complex question to answer, and then I'll attempt to answer it. One of the things is that there are definitely geographic differences that arise. And this is not unusual because during the time when persecution is a possibility, communication is somewhat hampered. Now, it's not as if there was no communication, because we have all kinds of letters going back and forth between individuals, but long distance and general communication was more difficult. Certainly, communication with a lot of people at the same time was difficult. Therefore, since the scripture has so many different nuances about God, and different people in different places were stressing portions of that, they tended to come up with some texts that supported their views without having a lot of communication with others about whether their views were being accepted. So, for instance, Origen, his views were not thoroughly accepted in Alexandria, and yet there was some acceptance of them, at least. It's not clear which details of what he was teaching got him thrown out of town. But he was thrown out of Alexandria and had to move up to Caesarea Maritima up in Israel because he was no longer welcome in Alexandria. But it wasn't clear which of his teachings was the problem. because we don't have letters, communication about that. So communication is a problem. So scriptures are revealing a bunch of things about Christ. And if you grab one or two of those texts, you might emphasize one aspect of it. Probably the best way to explain it would be, in the early Adventist church, we have a parallel. There was a tendency to not trust tradition. And Trinity is definitely a part of tradition. Plus, there was a group, a major group of early Adventists that were anti-Trinitarian. Not all of them, by any means, but those who had been connected with the Christian connection were definitely anti-Trinitarian. There were several other groups who were anti-Trinitarian as well. Those who were coming in from Methodism tended to be Trinitarian. So there was a grand mix in early Adventism, but there was a general distrust of tradition. And certainly Trinity was a traditional doctrine at that time. So many of them threw out the Trinity or rejected the Trinity just on the basis of it being a traditional doctrine. And they're saying, we don't find the Trinity as a doctrine in the scripture. And it's true, you don't find a section of Paul's writings marked. And as far as the Trinity is concerned, it is made up of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, three persons of one Godhead. Paul never says that. Paul does talk a number of times about the Holy Spirit, about God the Father and God the Son, and grace from all of them be with you, and those kinds of things. So Paul talks a lot about all three, and from Paul's writings, you can come up with a good function for all three of them as well. And you add John's writings, and you get another dynamic of the Holy Spirit, and certainly another dynamic of the relationship between Father and Son. And then you start adding Isaiah, and Psalms, and Proverbs, and you start adding more dynamics to it. In other words, it takes the whole Bible to build the doctrine of the Trinity. Because the doctrine of the Trinity is never singled out and described as a doctrine in the Bible. Same way with many other doctrines. We never have a doctrine of salvation that is clearly spelled out in full terms. Paul talks one way about salvation and the need for sanctification. He talks another way about salvation and this primacy of justification, et cetera, et cetera. You have to pull it all together in order to make a doctrine out of it. And you have to pull all of what Scripture says about God in order to build up a Trinity doctrine. Which means that in the early church, if you're emphasizing one part or another part, you have a tendency to have a piece of it, and then you have a presentation that's only partial. It's not until they started getting together and have communication that they started hammering out all that the Scripture said about Jesus Christ. And even then, it took them 50 years between Nicaea and the Council of Constantinople. So does that answer your question somewhat? Okay. Please. Okay.
Book of Bible.
Yeah.
You have Logos, Sophia, Dynamis, whatever that is.
Yes.
Because ultimately, the Christian church came out of Judaism.
Mm-hmm.
And to some extent, is there no Jewish understanding of God in terms of the Trinity that influences the Reinis or any of these guys? No?
Yes, there is. It's a good question. And let me give you an example. There's such a thing called the Targums. Okay, you're familiar with the Targums? They're Aramaic translations, paraphrases, maybe would be a better term, because they're not really slavishly holding themselves to the text of Scripture. They have a tendency to meander a bit and to explain a little bit as they go along. So I would call them paraphrases. So we have the Aramaic paraphrases of the Scripture that happened in the second, first, and centuries BC and the first century AD primarily. Okay? Two of them in particular I'm going to point out in their relationship to this discussion. There's Targum Neophyte. and Targum Jonathan. These two Targums in particular end up making a distinction in the Genesis creation story that is very interesting. As we are very aware, it says, "And God said, let there be." They were uncomfortable with God as the one source of all things actually being viewed in human terms as having a voice box and talking with the way humans talk. So they had a discomfort with the idea of God directly involved with creation. They wanted a demiurgos, as it were. They wanted a something in between, an intermediary between the one God and the earth. So Targum Neophiti and Jonathan both put in different places slightly, but both put in the same word. And it says, it goes something like this. Instead of saying, "And God said," and this is the Elohist section of Genesis 1, so it's Elohim Dabar, they inserted the term Mamre. Which is an interesting term, basically means Lord. Okay? And so they, instead of saying, "And Elohim Debar," of course they're doing it in Aramaic, so it's slightly different, but I don't know how to point Aramaic, so I can't pronounce it for you. But they would say, "The Mamre of God said, let there be light, and there was light. And the Mamre of God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures," etc., etc. Now, what is this term Mamre from, and what does it represent? We don't know exactly what it represents, but it looks like it's an agent of God. Where it comes from, it's a Babylonian term, meaning Lord. But they couldn't say, and the Lord of God said. So they changed it into a different language in order to come up with a different terminology that would make them more comfortable with the anthropomorphization of God. Because throughout all this, a big issue in Jewish interpretation of scriptures is the anthropomorphization of God in scripture. So one of the passages that many of them have trouble with is, "And God walked in the garden in the cool of the evening." They're really disturbed by that. They don't like the idea of the God of the universe walking in his creation. This disturbs them. But the very fact that they're disturbed by it and try to explain it in different ways alerts Christians to the idea that, hey, this was Jesus. This was one of the ways we can describe the Son. Whenever we find the anthropomorphization of God into walking or talking or dealing directly with humankind or with the world, the physical world, the Christians say, this is Jesus. This is God incarnate. Even anticipating it before, back at the creation of the world, this is Jesus involved in the creation of the world. Okay? So yes, the Jewish interpreters very much did influence the Christians in this. They wouldn't agree exactly, but Origen's view of Logos wouldn't be that far off of this, would it? Basically, Origen has the Logos as an agent of God, one of the souls as an agent of God. Very similar to what Philo has. Very similar to what Plato has with the Demiurgos. The dyad as Demiurgos. So, there's very much influence from Judaism on Christianity in these things. Now, was the influence helpful or was it harmful? That's still another one to grab and talk about. Okay, so does that answer your question? Okay. Now let's take a look at a couple of things Arius wrote and a couple of things Arius said as we're setting the stage for what's happening at Nicaea. Because when Alexander gets down to Nicaea, they start talking about how much they want to get rid of Sibelius, and Alexander says, wait a second, guys, I've got another problem. And Arius wrote something called the Thalia. Okay? It's unclear whether this was a letter or a treatise, something in between a letter or a treatise, but the Thalia has several statements in there that state or Arius's position. One of the statements in the Thalia that Arius made, and actually this one apparently is put to music and becomes a chant of sort that kids would say in the marketplace, and that the monks would repeat. But as there was a time when he was not. There was a time when he was not. He makes that as a statement that is attempting to bring to a logical situation an illogical statement of origin. Now, remember back in Plato, we talked about in the Timaeus, there was an instantaneous creation. And there was no time for Plato before the creation of the time pieces. So there is this, for lack of a better word, I'll call it a pre-time. So there's this pre-time of eternity before the existence of the cosmos, which then has timekeepers, i.e. the planets and stars. And the timekeepers now are what keep track of time. So before there was timekeepers, there was no time, according to Origen's understanding, Plato's understanding of time. And Origen buys into that. So Origen talks about Jesus Christ being God by participation, and he was born before time, generated in eternity. So is that description of time, or is that description of timelessness? It's up for grabs a little bit, I think. He's referring to the timelessness that Plato refers to before time. Okay? Arius disagrees with that. He is as much Aristotelian as he is Platonic. And he says, no, let's get down to Aristotelian logic here. You can't have time before time. You can't have that. It's just time is chronological and it marches on. Okay? But there was a time when he was not. In other words, he had an origin. And if he had an origin, then he had he had time before which he did not exist. So this is a defiant statement saying, let's admit that the source we're talking about over here is actual. And if the source happened, it must have happened in time. So before he was sourced, he was not. Now, this is a stark statement. This is saying that Jesus Christ is a created being. This is saying that when John says, before anything was created, he was with God, and through him all things were created, it would suggest then that he was saying that Jesus was created and then created everything else. Now this creates havoc, no pun intended, this makes havoc with the idea that there is a creator-creature divide. Athanasius is going to develop that thought later on in response to this. But can you picture here, if God is the creator and mortal beings are creatures, there's a nice clear divide between the two. But this messes up that divide. There was a time when he was not, says, he was created, and then he created everything else. So was he created as God? Because God is the creator. Or was he created, and how can you create a God? The definition of God, of course, means eternal. Okay? So if you can't have the definition of God being eternal and then have a created God, this solves one problem and causes another, at least one more. It creates havoc with all the statements that talk about the equality with God. The very nature of God, he thought it not robbery to take, Colossians 2 and Philippians 2. I mean, it creates havoc with those texts. Yeah. Proverbs 8:22.
Yeah.
Sophia in Proverbs 8:22.
Yeah.
This is a passage that Athanasius spends 180 pages explaining.
Right. But so he uses that where it does say that the wisdom was created and it was the first creation. And but then at the same time he's saying, you know, even before time God was with his thoughts and Jesus was essentially his thoughts.
You have put your thumb very well on the problem of Tertullian for the later church. He's ambiguous on that point. Okay? He is ambiguous on that point. He has this relationship, he has this relationship, but he doesn't explain how there. Because Tertullian's point is to make sure that there is same substance. That's the point Tertullian is making. True God from true God. But the from part, he doesn't explain. Now, what they explain later, and we'll get to that, is the eternal generation. This is what it comes out as in Augustine's De Trinitate. You get the eternal generation, and that's supposed to solve it. We'll get to that and criticize that when we get to it, but you put your thumb on the thing that disturbed people about Tertullian. He's ambiguous on the very point of what the from means. So Arius decides to explain it. He says, okay, here's what the from means. Now, what does this do to Christology? What does this do to Irenaeus' all true God, all true human? What does this do to salvation? We've got a created being that we're worshiping? We got a created being who's going to save us? It takes true God to save us, Irenaeus says. And I think he's right, and I think he's got scripture on his side there when he says it. But this causes havoc. This is a very low Christology. This makes Jesus kind of like Origen described him in stage 4 or stage 5 of the incarnation and the example. Remember our six pictures? Stage 4, the incarnation, he comes down and he shows us how to get up. How do we get up? Do what Jesus did. So Jesus didn't come, where's the cross in that? Jesus didn't come to die in your place. Jesus came to show you how you can live. And so this emphasizes Christ as brother, Christ as example. And it preaches well. Even to today, you want to get a conservative Christian audience excited, especially a conservative Adventist audience, start talking about Jesus' example and how he's doing what he did, we can do. And boy, it takes off. And pretty soon, you can put the cross aside and just talk example. We're all going to figure out how to live, and we're going to all do it. And praise God, we're all going to heaven because we're good enough. But there's a problem there. It doesn't solve the sin problem. Okay? So all of that is involved with statements like this. There was a time when he was not. It just takes away the true divinity of the Son. Because what kind of a God is it that was created? And of course, this also creates havoc with the understanding of why would we worship a creature? I mean, we get statements in Scripture where people are overwhelmed by the brightness and glory of an angel, and they bow down to worship. And what is said? No, see that you don't do it. I am a fellow creature like you are. Worship God. Got at least two statements almost exactly like that in Scripture. One of them in Revelation, when John, who knows better, he just gets so overwhelmed by the presence and the glory of the angel, he bows down and the angel says, see that you do not do it. I am a fellow creature. A fellow creature. A fellow creature can be an example, but ought not be worshipped. So there's a tension involved in this. And these things are said by Alexander of Alexandria in 325 at the Council of Nicaea, and suddenly everybody says, well, we thought Sibelius is bad. This Arius guy is terrible. And suddenly the focus shifts. They all came to the council saying, we're going to make sure we get rid of modalism. And now they're hearing this outrageous stuff, and lo and behold, Arius is in their very midst. He's sitting right there. And he stands up and says, yes, I say these things, but you're misunderstanding the context. And he starts to explain himself, blah, 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 blah. But he sticks by his statements. And now they have a present threat that overwhelms them from thinking of their past threat. After all, Paul of Samosata is dead. And Sibelius has been dead for a long time. We've got this Arius fellow right here in the room with us. We have to do something about this. What time is it?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay. Okay, so in the Thalia, he makes this statement. Now, this statement also has a tendency to... I'm going to go on from there. Okay, forget that. Okay, so Council of Nicaea, there's several things that happen. First of all, since Arius has gotten up and made this statement, the prepared statements against Sibelius don't seem to fit the situation anymore. And you know Eusebius of Caesarea. Eusebius of Caesarea figures that he's going to be the big man at the council. He's got a very large idea of his role at Constantine's council. After all, he's the one writing the Vita Constantine. He's the one writing the biography of Constantine. He's the one who's teaching Constantine how to be a proper Christian, et cetera, et cetera. So he's figuring he's got a big role here. And he is, after all, the bishop from Israel itself, from the Palestine itself. And the church in Jerusalem is kind of under his watch care. And so he brings the creed, apparently, the creed from Jerusalem. Later on, no one would identify with it because it gets rejected by the council, and so nobody wants to identify with it. So the people of Jerusalem said, oh yeah, that was our creed. Nobody wanted to say that. But anyway, Eusebius of Caesarea, the great historian, brings this creed and tries it out on the council. And it may have been a creed that would have gotten rid of Sabellianism. But it does not touch Arianism. Which, of course, who could anticipate? It came up during the council, as far as most of them were concerned. Alexander had been thinking of it for a while, but he hadn't been able to communicate it. And so when they get there with Arius in tow, he expresses this, and now Eusebius of Caesarea's prepared statement doesn't fit the problem anymore and is voted down. And he is absolutely crushed and a bit peeved, maybe even angry. And he goes to a back bench and sits and mopes the rest of the council. But guess what? Everybody just ignored him and they went on. So they start saying, okay, what are we going to do with this Arius guy? We have to get rid of Arius. The key to get rid of Arius is to emphasize true God from true God. To emphasize all God. If we have actual substance, actual nature of God with Jesus, that would get rid of this description from Arius, this understanding of Jesus as a created being who then participates or becomes God by creation. How's that work? We don't even understand it, but we can get rid of it with something like this. Homoousios. Two terms put together. Hamas. Greek scholars. What is Hamas? Same, okay. As opposed to heteros, which is different. Okay, so same. Ousios. Intended here to mean nature. Okay, the Son is homoousios with the Father. The Son has the same nature as the Father. Now, if the Son has the same nature as the Father, that would absolutely destroy Arius' position, right? Because if it's the same nature, you can't have one of them be creator and the other be created, and also creator, because created cannot be the same nature as God the Father. So clearly, if you have the Son has the same nature as the Father, Arius is out. And the argument is made. And Arius is being shunned. And the statement is drawn up. The statement includes homoousios, intending to mean the Son has the same nature as the Father. And it would rebel against all that Arius is teaching. And so it's signed by everybody at the council except three. Three people won't sign it. Arius won't sign it. And Eusebius of Nicomedia will not sign it. Eusebius of Nicomedia. Now, I'm just introducing him for the first time, so I'll explain a little bit about him. I have to get a little background. And then there's one other guy that didn't sign it, and I forget who it is right now. But it's not important for our argument here. So who's Eusebius of Nicomedia who comes to Arius' side and won't sign the document? Eusebius of Nicomedia had been a student in the school of Lucian of Antioch. Guess what? That's where Arius got his schooling from. The school of Lucian of Antioch. Now, we don't know what Lucian taught. And it had been assumed for many years that Lucian taught something that Arius picked up from him, and so Arianism actually comes from Lucianism. And the proof of the pudding, they argued, those that were arguing this, was that Eusebius of Nicomedia, also a student of Lucian of Antioch, would not sign the same thing that Arius would not sign. So they figured that Lucian of Antioch must have been a proto-Arian, and that Eusebius of Nicomedia must have been an Arian as well, and then Arius himself, of course, was an Arian, And they must have all agreed, and that's why Eusebius of Nicomedia wouldn't sign. Nothing is quite that simple. And we're running out of time now, so I'll have to unpack this tomorrow. But the reality is, Eusebius of Nicomedia apparently was not so much in favor of Arius as he was in favor of not condemning people, including one of his friends from school. So he did not so much agree with Arius as he did not think that Arius should be condemned. And he did not want to have statements to be signed that too closely defined what the relationship between the Father and the Son is and all the problems that come from that. Do I have 2 minutes left? Ish? Okay, so it's gone. Let me introduce the problem that we're going to stew on overnight, and then I'll give the complete description of it tomorrow. Short story here, long story tomorrow. Homoousios is the creed that the bishops went home with. And when they got home, they figured that everybody was going to be very happy that they got rid of this terrible idea that Arius had brought up at the council. Actually, Alexander brought it up, but Arius was there. When they got home, they actually discovered that nobody was happy with them. You see, homoousios was intended to mean same nature, but it can also mean same person, because ousios by itself is used both as nature and as person in philosophical writings. And so the semantic field of ousios can mean person also. So suddenly they realized as they went home, homoousios can be understood as the Son is the same person as the Father. Guess who's been saying that all along? So the people back home said, we send you to a council to get rid of modalism. You come back with a term that is not even in the Bible. It's a philosophical term. And it doesn't get rid of modalism. Failure on all three accounts. And everybody starts backing away from the homoousios formula.